my tears have been used all on another love, another love. Oh, my tears have been used all. Somewhere, you know I care, but it's so cold and I don't know where. I brought you daffodils on a pretty string, but they won't flower like they did last spring. And I wanna kiss you, make you feel alright. I'm just so tired to share my nights. I wanna cry. and somewhere, you know I care, but it's so cold and I don't know where. I brought you daffodils on a pretty string, but they won't flower like the last spring.
No se oye, ahora sí. Bueno, buenos días a todos. Bienvenidos a vuestra casa, el auditorio de WP, una vez más a todo el equipo de WAS y a todo el mundo de la red WAS. Soy Juan Pedro Moreno, presidente de WP, reciente presidente de WP. Llevo escasos dos meses, pero bueno, como os he comentado en alguna otra ocasión, orgullosísimo también de daros acogida y apoyo a esta iniciativa tan magnífica como la que lidera Mónica Chao. Voy a hacer la intervención en inglés y en español porque creo que hay gente conectada y en streaming que no es de habla española o que puede no ser de habla española y bueno, pues tenemos aquí una pequeña mezcla. Así que welcome everyone here on WASP People and Network. I'm very delighted to have here with us today this team to talk about about a very relevant topic like finance and sustainability, which is a really interesting discussion. And I particularly like the idea of finance fueling the system. I mean, the title you have choose, no? The idea of finance fuel for action. And it is really interesting because I really believe that finance is really the fuel that moves the economy and is the lever as well to make a lot of things happen. I always remember this song from Liza Minnelli, you probably will remember with me, that money makes the world go round, no? El dinero es lo que mueve el mundo. And this is true in any case, no? So if we really want to move the world, to change the world into sustainability, we need to keep in mind that money makes the world go round. And this is what it is about. Finance is a very relevant part of the value chain in an economy that makes things happen as well, in different dimensions, no? So that's why I really like the idea of this discussion, no? And I just took some notes around the four areas I think a bank or the finance world can help here, no? The first, I mean, is the most obvious one, which is the carbon footprint of the banking sector or the finance sector. That probably is not that obvious, but it's really an amazing footprint of carbon. If we think of the branches banks have around the world, the data processing centers they have around the world, the electricity consumption they have. So banks across the world and finance institutions are really a relevant actor as well on this. But this is the most obvious one. I think there are another three that are absolutely relevant, and I guess you are going to be talking about this today. The first one is investors more and more are sensitive around ESG, around the three letters, E, S, and G. So we are starting to see a lot of activism on the investors, and this is something that is a fantastic lever on your purpose, on our purpose, no? And you see the activism of the investors around ESG. Second is more and more citizens, consumers, voters, are more and more sensitive about ESG. And that means that we like products that are respectful and aligned with that purpose of ESG. Similar than probably you won't never again wear clothes that has been produced polluting the ocean or polluting the atmosphere, probably you won't buy or invest in products that are not contributing to ESG purposes, no? And the last one, and what I think is very important, and I want to take your attention on that, is banks are a very relevant lever on one of the letters of the ESG, which is the S of social. Really, the social purpose of banks on really fighting for the unbanked situation, killing economic vulnerability around the world, allowing access to credit and banking services to people that otherwise won't be accessible is really a very relevant contribution for banks. So I think there are four dimensions that makes this discussion you are gonna have today really relevant for the ESG purposes and for the sustainability of the world, since, as Liza Minnelli said, if money really makes the world go around and we try to move the world go around, starting with finance is a very important element. And just to, my final remark is to keep in mind that the finance world is not only financial institutions, it's also insurance. Insurers are really, really big investors and are really, really big levers with their investments on the ESG. And they are doing a lot of things as well. So keeping in mind not only banks and financial institutions, but also insurers, I think is very relevant. So I hope you enjoy the session today. And again, you are always welcome to WPP. We are part of WAS, and we are delighted to contribute. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Juan Pedro. Thank you for your words and also for hosting us here today. We are so happy that you are a partner of WAS and we can be here with our events, no, talking about sustainability and sustainable transformation. Welcome all of you. Welcome those that are here with us in this place, in this incredible place that we enjoy always that we are together here. And also thank you to the ones that are in streaming, talking about thinking with us about this relevant topic. For those that you don't know us yet, we are WAS. WAS is an association of women working for sustainability. We are more than 150 women working in management levels in companies, in non-profit organizations, and also in public administration, trying to move sustainability from the tables or where the decisions are taken. And we are happy because we are a challenge, we work for a challenge, two challenges, the challenge about sustainability and the challenge of diversity. So working in diversity and working in sustainability is one of the most, I don't know how to explain, the most relevant topics where we can be those days, you know, creating this transformation for the future. We have been working for 2 years. We were created in 2020. In these 2 years, we have been working in different topics that are key for this transformation. We are working creating knowledge, creating awareness. We know that many people trust in our documents, in our reports, and we have a position with our work to serve society, serve business, and create action. As Juan Pedro said, the name of this report is just an example of our energy when we work in sustainability. So thank you for being here today, because as you said, Juan Pedro, bringing together sustainability with capital markets are key. So sometimes when we talk about sustainability in our society, we talk about science, and science is key. But move decisions and think from our economy and think from businesses are key for creating this transformation. So thank you to all of you that are here with us for thinking today and thinking in coming days and in the future for creating this transformation. And I want to thank to the people that made possible this. I want to thank to Schneider Electric. They have been working in this report. So thank you, Schneider, and thank you, Raquel, for being the sponsor of this report. Thank you to all the companies that have been part of the surveys and the conversations that we have to create this report. Also to our sponsors that you can see here in the screen, sponsors that are that sponsor us in our activity. And also the working group of climate change. We are an association that work based on working groups. We have a working group for climate change that is led by Raquel Espada, by Ana Peña, that's there. So thank you for being so supportive to our association leading this relevant group. And also thank you to all the speakers that are here with you today. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your energy. We are looking forward to hear your thinkings. No more. Thank you and welcome.
Well, so thank you very much. Thank you, Monica. Thank you to WPP. Thank you to the working group. And just two things before we start with the things we want to discuss today. Two things. The first thing is you're going to see a visual thinking. Visual thinking, it's someone is drawing the conclusions and the things that we are talking about, the discussions that are taking place today here in this Edificio La Matriz in Madrid. So you're going to see it in your screens. You're going to see it in the screen that for the people that it's online. Also, you're going to see it there. So just that's one thing. And the other thing is we would like today not only to discuss about finance, but to discuss about action. And the action, we were talking about action for the last 2 weeks in the COP27. So today we want to speak about What is happening now? What happened in the COP27? So now we are going to have the pleasure of hearing Raquel Espada, Vice President, Strategy, EMEA for Sustainability, Schneider Electric. She's going to speak about the conclusions of the COP27. And then afterwards, we're going to hear about the report that that this working group with a lot of partners and people that were part of this study. We're going to speak about conclusions of the COP27, and then Irina Givanova, Associate Director of Private Equity and Sustainability for Schneider Electric, is going to speak about the report that the working group of WASS with Schneider Electric and the rest of the companies that were part of this report, they're going to have conclusions. So thank you very much. Thank you for being here, and thank you for the people all that is also behind the screens.
So thank you, everybody, to come here today. I think we were just talking before coming that one of the main problems we have by now is urgency. Everything is in a rush. Everybody's running. And time is the most important thing in life. And one of the main problems we have right now is we don't have time. And this is what is happening with climate change. And during the conference of climate change, we talk about innovation, we talk about technology, we talk about green taxonomy, we talk about compensation offsettings. And there was a comment with Carles Navarro, president from BAS, and he said, "We don't have time. It's the most precious thing." And with the current landscape, what we are revising is lack of resources. We're having problems with energy. We're having problems with gas. There is going to be a scarcity. And it's something we were never used to. And we need to change our mindset. So what has happened in COP? And I think we have mixed feelings. It's a bit bittersweet. When you work on sustainability, you really want that the change happens. And I think many of the climate change group have been there, have been at COP27. But what we saw there is it was good for adaptation. It was good for justice. And we saw that the adaptation fund that were defined have been quite good for the emerging countries, but we were not bold on climate. There were a lot of tension on the negotiations. Some countries wanted to go out from the 1.5 limit. And in the end, we were able to maintain the limit. And what we need to understand is the 1.5 degrees, this is not a goal. This is a limit, a physical limit. There is physical boundaries with it. And I think people need to understand that. And it's not a political conclusion. It's not that business wants to make it. We really have a challenge or a problem in that sense. So outcomes. So there was the agreement that it was a really important agreement on loss and damage, which is good. And we were able to limit the global temperature. But there was no agreement, which I think it was one of the main problems on the COP27, on phase out fossil fuels. And this has been a big deal. And we were not able to make it. So I think we also We are really optimistic, and I think one of the best things on WAS is we are here to make a change, and we are always positive and optimistic, but we need to be also autocritic. Sometimes as society, but also as companies, and even as individuals, we have Black Friday. Some companies like IKEA are doing the Green Friday. We really need to make a change and not use clothes that you just dispose from one day to another. And this is really, really important. So I think in numbers, interesting things, 151 countries sign up the Global Methane Pledge, which is quite important. And there was the basis of the adaptation strategy that will be defined in COP28. If we talk about countries, as we say, from all the countries that make the pledge on COP26, only 30 countries are delivering the commitments. This is something to think about. It's a really slow number. And good things on commitments, the European Union decided to increase by 2% from 55 to 57% the reduction on emissions, so this is a really positive impact. USA allocate 20 billion in new investments to reduce the new fossil, the metal emissions, and they also make some commitments, for example, on heavy duty vehicles by 2040, which is a big emission on transportation over there. Some countries like Mexico take a commitment. It's going to 35%. That was a big deal for them, which is interesting because it's a big emerging economy. And some countries like India started to make also some deals to phase out fossil fuels. China was the bit missing part, and we cannot avoid talking about China. It's one of the biggest economy. And there was also the initiative in Africa for carbon markets initiative. We can see a graphic here from Bloomberg that they are making a kind of a ranking every year. And last year, they put COP26 at 6 points. This year, they go to 3.7. So I think we need to think about, and as we say, quite good on loss and damage, but not so good on the Paris climate targets. We were not bold on mitigation. We were not bold on sustainable finance for long term, and we were not bold on some of the potential carbon markets that should be developed. If we talk about the sustainable finance, I think, as we say, investor community and many of the CEOs from climate make a big request to the countries to make bigger commitments. It has not happened. Countries also call attention to the World Bank to make some reforms for the development banks. And we need nearly 2.4 trillion per year to 2030 to make it happen. So the financial sector was claiming is that we need consistency. And sometimes there is a lack of consistency on some policies or regulations. There is also a lack of clear climate standards or frameworks. And we are going to see that on the report. And I think this is data frameworks has been a topic that came into attention from the report. And then, as we say, achievements, the Loss and Damage Fund was really good, the Global Seed Financial Facility. I don't want to talk about because some of you are from the Net Zero Owners Alliance or from the Net Zero Backing Alliance, and you can come more into details over there. But one of the other topics that came over during the COP, it was and mainly from the finance or investing institutions, it was the importance of the lack of greenwashing and that there are steps or milestones to really measure that the companies are making these changes. So I would like to thank, and I know Monica has done, but I really want to thank to the Climate Change Group, liderated by Anna, and also to this to the team that support this this report. I want to thank mainly Delia Garcia. I want to thank Anna Ariño, Elena Blanco. But I really want to thank also three people which have been working on the conferences. And in the end of the day, we need action, but we need things to happen. So big applause to Elena Galante, Elena Bau, and Patricia La Palana because the conference could not have happened if they were not here. So really, really appreciate their efforts. I really want, and we have here, to thank the Minister of Economy and Digital Transformation here in Spain. I want to thank Ana for coming, for supporting us on the report. And when you see the report, she wrote something for us. And because I think one of the things we can never, and I was yesterday on the event of Economista, and it was an interesting chat with Nadia Calviño, where we cannot never think the private and public sector have to work together. So thank you very much. And really big thanks to the speakers from today and to all the stakeholders, financial stakeholders, who work with us on the surveys and qualitative and quantitative interviews. Because when we decided to make this report, it was because most of the people on the climate change group, they are sustainability managers, and they were having some challenges with how to present information to financial stakeholders, how to showcase how they are delivering action, because in many cases they get different information, different standards, and we decided to put voice to the financial world so that they can say, okay, this is what we are looking, this is the opportunities we want to revise. So thank you also very much to Tania and Irina, who have been making this report. And then I pass through to Irina, who is going to explain the conclusions of the report.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure for me to present some findings from the report today. And I would like just to add to what previous speakers were saying. We're extremely grateful to everyone who contributed and provided their insights, being practitioners, trying to drive a lot of these issues and questions we'll be discussing in the report. It was, for me personally, exciting opportunity to talk what is really happening on the ground. And that's what we would like to share in this report as well. I'd like to start with some key trends that were identified throughout the surveys, throughout the interviews, and our discussions with different stakeholders. First of all and foremost, it's clear that ESG is really on the rise on the investors' agenda. It's really high, it's important, and all the global disruptions we are facing today in the post-pandemic world, in the world of various geopolitical tensions, it's clear that there is even further interest and attention to these topics from investors. Second of all, we've mentioned there is certain lack of public actions, of common framework and regulations, but a lot of things actually are happening. A lot of regulations are coming up in different parts of the world. A lot of non-regulatory best practice standards are there to support sustainable finance and disclosure. And last but not least, ESG pays, climate preparedness pays. It's clear, and there are a lot of evidence and research already available showing the clear link between ESG performance and financial performance of the companies. So companies who are actually better performing on various ESG topics likely be more competitive, likely to be more interesting from the investment perspective. And therefore, it was for me again really exciting to see that 90% of the respondents confirmed that climate impact already part of their investment strategy. And this is really, really interesting message. In terms of some of the initiatives, and I'm not going to discuss those in detail, I'm pretty sure, especially those who are from the sector, you're very familiar with some of those frameworks and the global initiatives around climate disclosure, around sustainable finance, PRI, task force for climate-related disclosures, science-based targets for climate target setting, and all of that. Maybe just to mention that some of those initiatives are also being now included and incorporated into regulatory requirements. So this is not just some global good guidance available for the sector, but it's also becoming mandatory for many participants to have it included in the in their reports. Now, speaking of some of the key pillars of sustainable investment strategy, we would like to highlight three of them. First of all, risk management is the bridge between sustainability and finance. So sustainability is not any longer some marketing strategy that is being undertaken by investors. It's their way to manage the risk. It's their way to actually secure long-term risk adjustment returns. And among the different ESG topics, and again, it's a huge universe of different topics and matters, it's clear that environment is prevailing. And among the different environmental impacts, climate is definitely dominating, and this is being the most cited impact that is driving a lot of actions in this space. And last but not least, the call for engagement. Again, personally, this was absolutely thrilling to me to see that majority of our respondents were talking about engagement, about driving the impact, about inclusionary investing, actively investing into those assets and into those companies who are taking ESG seriously, who are performing better in sustainability versus just divestment strategy. Yes, we need to shift the capital from some oil and gas industry potentially and also fuel the capital into renewable sector. All of this is clear, but nevertheless, if we are really to drive the serious impact and serious transformation on the ESG, we need to keep driving this within those sectors, keep trying to change the ways they are working and incorporating the ESG into their business strategy. In terms of some of the key challenges identified, and by the way, I have to say they're not just limited to these four. They are, of course, different across different type of, for example, investors or type of assets we are talking about, regions, sectors. So there are some specific challenges, of course, related to all of that. But to emphasize maybe some common challenges, one of the interesting ones that was mentioned by many of our respondents is lack of ability to measure the impact. So again, back to the previous point, it's clear that those who are performing better on ESG and sustainability potentially perform better as well on financially as a business. However, there is no calculator. There is no like clear tool which would allow to create the business case and show by improving X percent on that ESG KPI, how much of improvement on the returns I can get from that. So, right, this is not there, and this makes it sometimes harder to drive these topics internally in the sector. Majority of investors also were referring to issues of lack of data and lack of comparable and meaningful data, reliable data. And again, this is something that is being now everywhere on the news, all these greenwashing claims, all the issues around misinterpreting the data or misleading customers or external stakeholders about the performance. So this is also something that investors are facing when they're trying to understand how their portfolios perform. And this is a fundamental issue that needs to be, of course, addressed through a lot of initiatives, including regulatory initiatives, including regulatory clear framework, how to speak common language when we are talking about ESG. Some respondents also confirmed that lack of top management buy-in and involvement from the corporate side is another bottleneck for driving this ESG transformation at the asset level or the corporate level. So again, it's clear that it needs to be discussed on the board level to make it happen. And it was interesting for me to see that some of the ways how investors and respondents were thinking about it, that potentially we need to make it really mandatory to connect the remuneration and assessment of top management performance to performance on the ESG of the company. That could really potentially drive the change at the corporate level. And last but not least, challenging topics. Again, ESG is a big universe of different topics. Some of those are being really well understood. There are some frameworks, there are best case practices and understanding how to drive those changes on those topics. But among them, there are some which are a bit more challenging or controversial or just difficult to address. Among three top topics on that, there were mentioned biodiversity, circularity and use of natural resources, and diversity and inclusion. Those were found to be difficult to address, mainly because there is no, again, common understanding, unlike, for example, for climate, when it's clear we have to be at the point of 1.5 degree of global warming. Here is no clear metrics where we should be on some of those topics and impacts. So now I would like to move on to a positive part of our presentation and the report and focus on some solutions and recommendations that were provided to investors and investees. First of all, in terms of the solution, and that's what mentioned already by previous speakers as well, we need really to have the universal and standardized framework. Again, we need to speak common language when we talk about ESG. And of course, there will be certain flexibility and collaboration needed to address some sector-specific challenges when it comes to certain topics or some peculiarities when it comes to different countries and regions. But it should be common language, it should be common framework across the board on those topics. In terms of other topics, the long-term perspective, right? The business case is there, sustainability pace, as we've just discussed, but the time horizon should be expanded beyond short-term. We cannot anymore talk about 3-4 years time horizon when discussing the business case of sustainability. A lot of these topics really can be understood, or the business case can be understood, if we look long-term, 5-10 years ahead, and that's when you will find that it really pays. Apologies again for that, for switching off the slides. Make use of best practices. That's again something that is already available, especially in the sector. A lot of quite advanced solutions are available, such as green bonds, ESG-linked loans, and all of the different sustainable financial products that may help to accelerate the implementation of sustainability investment strategy. The financial incentives, again, ideally it would be great to have some global financial incentives, such as, for example, global carbon tax. But in the meantime, we can make use of what is available and the instruments that are available to integrate it into financial planning during the investment life cycle. And last but not least, collaboration. And that's something that was mentioned also by Raquel previously and by previous speakers. It is important to make sure that we have collaboration between public and private. Otherwise, the fair and fast transition simply won't happen. Right, in terms of some of the recommendations that were drawn to the investors, key 5 recommendations that were provided by our respondents and can be concluded from the survey results. Beginning from establishing of ESG strategy, the clear one with the expectations of the results, but also with ambitious targets. And again, there is not always the clear pathway how to achieve the targets. We don't always have the answers how to get there, but we need to aim high. We need to aim high, and we need to really try to deliver on those ambitious targets. Streamline disclosure requirements to investees. And by the way, that was the comment that was also coming from many investor relations teams, that sometimes there are a bit too creative or too agile requests coming from the investors, right? Asking for too many information, repetitive surveys, repetitive requests to ask about the same topic, basically. So streamline that, make use of what is existing there in terms of regulatory requirements, and make sure that they can benefit by simplifying the reporting process. Integrate ESG throughout the whole investment cycle and start from due diligence. ESG should be part of your early discussion or understanding of the potential impact that can be created on the corporate level, on the asset level you are going to invest to. Adapt, test, and learn mindset. So again, we're still learning on a lot of these matters, on a lot of these topics. You need to be ready to test and learn. And of course, again, share the best practice across the sectors, across your own investees, make use of the lessons learned. And last but not least, keep going. Keep going to go faster. There will be always ambiguity. There will be always some immature frameworks or lack of incentives at country level. But you cannot wait until sustainability is done. It's never done. You need to get started. You need to engage with your investees, and you need to do it now. We are out of time, as Raquel was mentioning previously. And in terms of the recommendations of for investees, again, they're quite aligned, actually, with what is being recommended to investors, beginning from clear, transparent strategy, what are you trying to achieve. Your business, you should demonstrate that your business is really ready for ESG transformation. Proactively collect and report on data. Again, data, as you have heard, is an issue. That's what helps your investors to understand where you are on your ESG journey, where they can create some impact, where they can help you to deliver the required change. And use of digital technologies and connected platforms will be, of course, key in this process. Assigned responsibility to the board. Again, nothing would happen if there is no top management responsibility and accountability. Consider linking remuneration incentives to ESG performance. This is important. This is what truly drives many initiatives when it comes from the board. maintain long-term vision while addressing short-term actions. And again, especially today, I think everybody's facing that. There is need to address a lot of emergency issues. Businesses are trying to survive to address some of those, and it's really hard to stay, to keep focus on also on long-term challenges, right? But it is important because otherwise we will not get there. Climate crisis will not disappear just because we are trying to face short-term energy crisis, especially in this part of the region. So keep in mind you need to deliver on long-term commitments and the results. And last but not least, and also very close to my heart, as the person who used to work a lot in sustainability and working with different companies and responsible people within those companies, we really need to create some agile governance structure. We shouldn't expect that it should be done by the person with the title, including sustainability. It's never done like that. It should be really baked in into job requirements across the board, starting from top management, but also across different functional leaders. HR, procurement, finance, they all should be on board. They all should have their own accountability and responsibility when it comes to ESG. And there should be no expectation that some sustainability leader or even chief sustainability officer will drive it on its own. Right, and last but not least, before we move on to our roundtable discussion, we have a couple of notes here and thoughts from investors, and I'm not going to read it out loud because I think we will have a chance to actually hear it from them today. Key message is definitely really again on the rise, on the agenda. A lot of things are happening, a lot of activities, and maybe again just to mention something close to my heart and the reason why I was really interested in driving those changes and collaborating with financial institutions because of the scale of the impact. Right. So, for example, we worked with one of the Swedish private equities called EQT, supporting with the net zero journey across the entire portfolio, starting from very high top level strategy established for the private equity firm, but also then working with each of the portfolio companies within the same program to define the strategy, to define the targets, to define actionable roadmaps, so what they can do to start decarbonizing, not in 10 years by 2050, but next year, starting from renewable energy procurement or on-site transformation or working with the supply chain and the customers. And just witnessing that pace and the results that were achieved across multiple sectors, multiple sizes of the companies, embarking on this journey from the very state of the beginner, when they were just trying to understand what is footprint, how to measure emissions, and ending up with the commitment at the board level to set climate targets, that was astonishing. That was really impressive. And that's why I believe there is really a lot of potential in this sector, and that's why it's time to act. So with that, I would like to conclude and thank you again to everyone who helped us to build this report, and we can move on to our roundtable discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Irina. Thank you very much. And as we are talking about action, we want to share the actions that have been taken and must be taken by a fantastic group of people we have now here. I want to thank you all for being here and sharing your experience and your know-how with us. So let's take action. So we're going to go for the roundtable moderated by Tania Fernandez, Senior Consultant, Sustainability, Schneider Electric. And we're going to count on Mr. Aitor Jauregui, Managing Director of BlackRock Iberia. Thank you very much. Ms. Marisa Aguilar, Country Head for Iberia Alliance Global Investors. Thank you very much. Ms. Lara Marin, Head of Global Product at BBVA Asset Management. And Mr. Ricardo Vidal, Chief Investment Officer and Partner of EDM. Thank you all for being here. Let's take action. Let's talk about action. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah. So welcome to everybody. Thank you very much for being here. For me, it's a great pleasure to moderate this table. So Delia has already introduced you, but I would like to make another kind of introduction to set the basis for this roundtable. So just I would like to ask you to reflect on a quick question. So in a few words, what does a sustainable investment mean for each one of your organization? So maybe just 2 minutes each, if we can go, maybe Marisa.
Okay, ladies first. Okay. Yeah, well, Good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure.
Can I help you?
Yes, thank you. Because otherwise, I'm going to be here like half an hour trying to open it. Thank you, Aitor. That's very kind of you. So, well, my name is Marisa Aguilar. I'm the head of Allianz Global Investors for Iberia. So that means Spain and Portugal. Allianz Global Investors is an asset management, so it's an active investor in the market. But its parent company, I mean, our owner, it's Allianz, which is one of the biggest insurance companies of the world. Now, if you think about insurance companies, they've been, you know, aware of the climate change consequences and social impact for decades now. So for us, reflecting on that question on what sustainable investing means or what sustainable finance is, for us is both a duty and an opportunity. So a duty because we need to enact change. So we have to. There is no option, as Raquel pointed out before. An opportunity because as active investors, we have like two very important tools, capital allocation and you know, company engagement, for us to create that change. So, and it's an opportunity that we, you know, integrate in ESG information, ESG factors, ESG considerations in our portfolios, we can partner with our clients to basically achieve that change. So I would say that nowadays, because of many, many, many reasons we will discuss later, we just do sustainable finance. So better or worse, and we'll talk about that later, but that's what we do, basically.
Thank you very much. So your turn.
Thank you, Tania. Well, thanks to WAS and WPP for inviting us, and great to be here with you know, good friends. Well, my name is Aitor Jauregui. I'm the country manager for BlackRock in Iberia. We cover Spain, Portugal, and Andorra with a clear purpose, which is helping more and more people achieve financial well-being. So to your question on what is sustainable investing at BlackRock, well, sustainable investing is investing in progress. It is recognizing that you know, those companies that are solving the biggest challenges that we face are actually well positioned to grow. And why is that? Because they can have access to easier access to capital. So sustainable investing is basically pioneering on new ways of doing business. It's basically encouraging other companies to drive change and have an impact. So let me summarize. To us, sustainable investing is creating value for and being valued by all the shareholders, not only all the stakeholders, not only the shareholders, which of course are critical as investors in a company, but also when we consider the stakeholders as a whole, we mean taking care of employees, suppliers, providers, but also the entire ecosystem in which that company operates. So at BlackRock, basically we truly believe that integrating not only climate but also sustainable considerations into the investment process is going to help investors to get better returns and basically to achieve better long-term risk-adjusted returns in the long run.
Okay. Thank you very much. So,
hello, good morning. My name is Lara Marin. I'm the head of global product at BBVA Asset Management. And one of my roles is leading and coordinating our sustainability strategy, because in our organization, we had decided not to create a big sustainability area, but instead of, we have integrated the sustainability in all our teams, because we truly believe that it's something that it should be at the core of our business. Regarding what is a sustainable investment for us, well, it's not just managing ESG risks, but of course, it's a must. We are managers of the assets of our clients, and we need to take into account all of the risks. And ESG is a risk, so of course, we need to take it into account. But sustainability investments is an additional step. You are looking for the impact of your investment, for the goal of these investments, and the result of the investments. And of course, We truly believe that if we are looking for a good impact or a good performance in sustainable investment, for example, we have decided to adopt the framework of the SDGs, we think that at the end, it's not only good for these targets, it's going to be a good investment for our clients. So that's our approach.
Okay, perfect. So last but not least. For
sure. Hello, good morning. I'm Ricardo Vidal, the Chief Investment Officer at EDM. EDM is an independent asset manager founded more than 30 years ago. And we have branches in Barcelona, Madrid, and Luxembourg. And for us, sustainable investment now is at the roots of every investment. No? You cannot invest in the future looking ahead without taking account on sustainability. No? All of our funds are Article 8, so that means that investing in companies that promote environmental and social characteristics, and this is important for us, and we invest to them, we analyze them, and of course we do engagement, and we ask for companies that has policies to improve or to reduce energy consumption, to lower the carbon footprint, and of course other items, no, like gender diversity and so on.
Thank you very much. Very different perspective, but I think very complementary, and we'll go into details later. But now we have another general question, and it's related to the main purpose of this event. So as Irina just presented the report that we did. So I would want to know, what do you think about the title of the report? Because while some years ago, maybe sustainability and finance could seem like two opposing terms, now we are having an event about sustainable finance as a fuel for action. So why and how also do you think that this change of mindset has occurred?
Again?
We can change.
Whatever you say.
We have four questions for, for all of you.
I'm going to just throw some thoughts, okay? And then we can discuss those, okay? And I really like the introduction from Juan Pedro. I'm sorry if I'm not saying his name correctly, but you know about the Liza Minnelli thing that the, you know, that the money moves the world, actually, you know? So, I mean, if you want things happen, you need the money for, you know, for making them happen, actually. But I would say, you are talking about, you know, this change in mindset, and it's not as much change in a mindset as it is mainstreaming or democratizing sustainable investing, mm-hmm. because sustainable investing has been happening for decades now, but it was basically, limited to a niche kind of, segment for institutional investors, mainly European ones, big pension plans, big insurance companies that needed that kind of more, sometimes ethical, moral kind of, investments. And I think that there are several factors that have kind of, laid the field for this change, for this democratization. One, Lara has mentioned that, risk management. We all realized that this that we were doing in very small niche portfolios, it was good for all the rest of the of investments. So ESG risk management, that has been, probably when all, financial sector started to look at it seriously and, thinking about scaling it up. Second would be public action and regulatory, frameworks. We are nothing, meaning financial players are nothing if we don't have. So we are not fuel for action, real fuel for action, if we don't have the clear public frameworks that help us to operate with certainty, And another factor I would mention, new generations, right? And, mm-hmm. and changing client, behaviors and expectations I think that the new generations are much greener and sustainable than we were, than my generation was. I always say, and this is an anecdote, when I was a kid, we didn't even have, how you call them, las papeleras, rubbish?
Yeah, the recycling bins.
Yeah, in the street, right? So it was hard to throw a paper because you, so, okay. And then opportunities. Yeah, and for me, that's very exciting as an investor. If you think of all the capital, all the flows that are being moved towards the economic transition, that creates amazing opportunities for investors. So, and we want to be part of, you know, the smart energy movement and all these changes that are happening. So we could talk probably, I don't know, I'm sorry. But, this you, if you allow me first, then. So, so that's, those are the key factors I would highlight, I would say. I don't know.
Yeah, no, if I may, I mean, I couldn't agree more. I think, you know, you rightly pointed out a few topics. I think Raquel also mentioned some urgent needs that need to be addressed. And you mentioned, you know, climate change. But not only, I think when thinking of sustainable finance, we also need to think of energy security. We need to think on societal diversity as well. And obviously, regulation and different initiatives that have been driven last few years have helped to get a kind of a common language and transparency in those topics. Also, those developments made the financial sector, not only banking, but insurance, you know, the financial industry as a whole, basically be working on and focused on transforming the current environment. And that's why, yes, we've been talking for a while on sustainability, but this concept of sustainable finance has been a bit more, you know, recently raised. I think that the financial sector has a key, can be a key driver actually of this transformation. And why is that? I would probably, you know, say three reasons for that. One being, you know, they can unlock capital, and obviously there can be a lot of projects that can be financed through the financial sector. The second one being that you know, they can provide tools, they can provide guidance when it comes to risk management, for instance, on which companies to finance. And third, you know, they can offer, and they do offer, ESG-linked products. That can be not only investment products, but also loans, bonds, and you name it. So I think when it comes to, you know, having the finance sector paying a lot of attention, I think COP has done a, you know, good job there. Obviously, a lot of things to be done yet. But COP26 in Glasgow last year, I think they brought in the financial sector in the spotlight to basically accelerate this transformation. And, you know, I couldn't agree more with what we have seen in the report. This is a joint effort of both the public, the private, but also the public sector. And I think, governments, policymakers, they need to address this in order to speed up that transition.
I agree with all the comments that have been made previously by my colleagues in this panel. And in order to add an additional views, well, I would say that the reason is that maybe we are now in a virtuous circle, no? Because really, we have in favor the demand and the offer. The demand, because there has been a change of mindset in the society. So there is a demand of this new type of investment. There is a demand to the companies in order to doing business in another way. Really, nowadays, a company that has ESG problems, an event, the controversy in terms of ESG, maybe it will be in the situation of losing clients, losing business, or having sanctions or fines, or at the end, not being able to do its business. So really, the companies now need to adopt and to integrate the sustainability and the ESG issues in their business. And we as investors, of course, we need to take into account, because of course, if a company is doing bad in terms of ESG, at the end, it's going to be a bad investment with a bad performance. And we need to offer a good performance to our investors. So there's a new balance, no, in the terms of the decisions between in which companies invest And additionally, of course, in this new mindset and in this changing world and in this changing economy, there are a lot of new opportunities for investing and to aggregate value in our portfolios.
Yes, I agree with all of you, and we are at the end, as a managers, we are allocators of the money of our clients, no? Our clients' savings, and they are pushing us to take into account the sustainable investments, but also regulators, no? And that's important. And one of the things that I think Irina mentioned in the presentation is this decoupling, no? Between the long-term ESG goals and short-term that the market is asking for the companies, no? And it's important for us also that the company deliver economic returns, taking account the sustainable issues.
Okay, thank you very much. Like they just took it off, but I was very glad to have all the the key issues about the key concepts about all of you mentioned here. So now we are going to move on to the second part of this roundtable, and I would like to focus on each one of your organization. And so now we are going to start with you, Aitor.
Okay.
And I have two questions for you, well, two in one, because they are closely related, and it's linked to a growing interest concept, the need for a fair transition, mm-hmm. that has lately gained like a spotlight in various publications, reports, in many conversations. With this call for the need of trillions of investment in order to reach this net zero emission world. So what are the key actions, the key steps that do you think that need to be undertaken to achieve this ambitious transition? And how would you say that this is linked to the concept of resilience? And of course, what does the concept of resilience mean to BlackRock?
Okay, yeah, thank you. So I'll cover just a few questions there. So you mentioned the fair transition, trillions going into there. I'll start with that. And I couldn't agree more with what Marisa said. I think the transition brings a historic opportunity for investments. We've done a few analyses and we have quantified a little bit this, and we foresee that on a cumulative basis, if we do it right, this transition, it will bring cumulative 25% increase of the GDP globally in the next 2 decades. So that is roughly a 50 trillion opportunity. So, but in order to get there, obviously, we need to work together with the public sector. We need to make sure that transition is fair. So in order to get there, I think it's important that we also, and public policies as well, focus on the demand and not only on the supply side of things. That will channel a lot of opportunities and will make a bit more tangible for basically kind of the overall population globally. I think when we think of what has happened this year and more lately on the war in Ukraine, obviously there's been a lot of questions there on can this be kind of a stopper or an accelerator when it comes to the energy security, energy transition? What does it mean? Well, we at BlackRock think that this will only accelerate this trend. Why is that? Let me give you one example. But obviously, with energy prices as high as they've been, obviously the green premium becomes lower, is reduced, meaning that those investments in clean technologies, in renewable investments, are more appealing, more attractive for end investors. So I think this will drive a lot of capital, and this reallocation of capital we were referring to, that's what we think is gonna happen. So on your last question on resilience, well, we are fully committed at BlackRock with the transition. I think we need to help clients navigate this transition, but obviously this will take decades. We cannot go from dark brown into light greens in 2 years. We also truly believe that we need to work on engagement and basically having regular catch-ups with those companies in which we invest on behalf of our clients to basically, help them achieve their goals and transform their businesses as well. So, it will take time, but in order to get there, we need to be really ambitious as well.
Thank you. very comprehensive answer. And yeah, indeed, I think with that, this resilience is a key, at least the perspective of making these portfolios, as you were saying, like also resilience is a key pillar of the sustainable investment. And to move on to another key pillar, I have another question for you, Marisa, and it's linked with the concept of engagement that we also, Irina, highlighted today in the presentation of the report. So would you agree with this call for engagement with impact investing as a key for the success of sustainable finance? And for example, if we take the case of climate, which is maybe the topic with which we are more familiar to, what has been the experience with decarbonizing the high emitting portfolios? And also, and that was another topic that I think it's very interesting for the audience. How do you choose the companies you engage with? Because as you were saying during the interview, you have like 100,000 of companies and you cannot engage with all the your portfolio companies. So maybe one or two key factors that help you with it.
Help me not to forget, because there were many questions in your question.
Yeah,
and I have one question, but with
two or three questions.
I don't know how many of you come from finance, and I will be delighted to discuss this later on, but I would distinguish between company engagement and impact investing.
Yeah.
I mean, for us, company engagement is like a sort of, it's an overlay we can apply for any of our sustainable investing techniques. So you can do best-in-class investing and still engage with companies. You can do green bond portfolio and still engage with companies. You can do an impact portfolio and engage with companies. So there is a nuance there, quite a big one. But anyway, it is interesting that you link both concepts, because it is true that more and more sustainable finance and sustainable investing, it's evolving towards more outcome-oriented portfolios. So in the past, it was more about footprinting, so about how companies, perform their functions, their, tasks. We are now shifting more and more towards what, how do they impact, what do they produce, what are the, the services and products they come up with, and what's the impact on society, on the climate of those products and services. So this is happening, As for engagement, usually we talk about stewardship, so how we relate to our investee companies, and how we can influence. So we have typically two tools. One is engagement, another one is proxy voting, the voting right exercise. We can perform, So we have general programs for proxy voting and for engagement. To another of your questions, going down specifically to engagement, which is a more, kind of direct relationship with the companies in which we invest. So we develop dialogues, we understand how they are designing their long-term strategies. When I'm talking here about what you said, decarbonizing, particularly in the high emitting sectors. So what we want to understand is that they have a good transition planning, that they are getting help, for example, from initiatives like the science-based target initiative, so science-based planning. We want also to understand their challenges. Sometimes we even organize workshops so that, we can help them understand the best practices at a sector level. But obviously, I'm not gonna lie to you, we cannot do that with all the companies we invest in. So for you just to understand, the difference in both tools, proxy voting versus engagement, a company my size, and I here have the biggest asset manager in the world, but my size, which is around 600 billion euros, we exercise the proxy voting in around 10,500 companies. So this is because we are equity investors there. We engage with around 300-400 companies, right? So it's a kind of bi-directional thing. So the company needs to be important for you, and you need to be important for the company. And results are not immediate. results are going to come over the long term. That's why you need to be an active and long-term investor, because otherwise it doesn't make a sense for you, you know, to invest so much energy and resources in engaging with the company. So that gives you, I hope, some clues about, you know, how different the two things are. And that's why collective engagement is so important. And this was mentioned before, and I think it has been mentioned in the report. Irina pointed that out, also Raquel. Collaboration. I cannot think of any better discipline than sustainability for collaboration. I mean, it's about adding efforts. So maybe I'm not important for Apple, but maybe all these four companies together, we are starting to be quite important for Apple, right? So maybe Apple will listen to us, and that's collective engagement. Through, you know, there are many, many initiatives. Just to mention Climate Action 100 Plus, you know, that's an important one. I think, you know, we are here, members of the, or Aitor mentioned that before. You know, for example, my company, my parent company, chairs the Asset Owner Net Zero Alliance, and we are part also of the Asset Management Net Zero Alliance. So it's through this, you know, networking, collaboration, where we add knowledge and we add influence, and we can go out there to the companies and help them understand what we need to invest and help them to build this kind of, you know, long-term and but credible pathways towards, you know, a different and more greener, hopefully, economy.
Thank you for very, very interesting concepts. And indeed, like, I think the call for engagement, we all call for engagement, but it's not easy, as you as you just say. And maybe this collective engagement is something that investors don't think about that at first. But yeah, indeed, like, maybe one individual investor firm won't make any impact, but four or five, if they align with the interest, they will get to have this change of mindset maybe in the company. So, I think very, very interesting perspective. And so, Lara, to continue with these enablers, we have a question for you regarding a key topic today. So, yeah, I think we cannot have a discussion about sustainable investment without talking about the current regulation, the new coming regulation from the European Union. So, first, a more general question: what do you think that are the key enablers that will help you to make sustainable investments a success for your organization? And do you think that is actually these requirements and maybe more clarity in these new requirements, new regulation, and maybe making them mandatory for investors in order to have this standardized access to data? And in to sum up, what is your perspective regarding the regulations?
Well, first of all, I think that the neighbors, in order to reach the success integrating sustainability, the first enable is internal, no? You need, as an organization, to set the sustainability as a priority, and this must be an internal priority. Then define what are your targets, your goals, the purpose, no? The aim that you are pursuing with the sustainability, and then, well, to define your plan, the steps that you like to take in, and the calendar, no? The calendar of the different deliveries, because you need to prioritize. There is a lot of things to do, so you need to prioritize. So first of all, you need the internal commitment. Fortunately, in our case, I would say that we have this internal commitment. It's a priority for our organization, as a parent entity, no, as BBVA Group, but also, you know, at the level of BBVA Asset Management. So this is the first requirement you need to integrate as a priority, because if not, it's just only because the regulation is requiring you to comply with sustainability, well, you do the minimum, no, in order to make the tick, I comply with regulation, but at the end it's not going to be a successful strategy, because at the end you need to devote resources for one side, because you have the regulatory requirements, but it's not done with a conviction. At the end, you don't have good results, and you are not going to deliver a good products or a good management to your clients in terms of sustainability. So at the end, it's not good, first of all, for your business. So the first enable is an internal. And of course, you have the external enables. And we have commented, you know, the change of mindset in the society and a lot of things. But of course, it's regulation in the case of the European Union. It's key, no? The regulation that is moving very faster. We have the whole package that the European Union is developing around the sustainability with the aim to move the financial system in order to finance, no? The climate change, the climate transition, in order to change the mindset of the investors to the long-term perspective, no? So that's good, and of course, it's a key driver in order to integrate sustainability. I think that it's a good idea to have a whole package and to look at to the all the chain, all the financial system, or to all the participants, because the regulation is looking at the asset managers, to the banks, to the insurance, to the investees, to the ESG data providers. So yes, I think that is an holistic regulation. What's the problem? That because it's an holistic regulation, we have a lot of norms, a lot of rules that are different. And in some cases, they are addressing the same concept. For example, what is a sustainable investment? And we have different definitions that are in the different regulations. You have the sustainability preference at MIFID, you have the taxonomy regulation, but you have the SFDR regulation. And in each piece of the regulation, the concept of sustainable is totally different, but it's not exactly the same. So that's a problem. And another problem is that you have different dates of entry into force. So the combination, well, is a problem for us as investors in order to define what is a sustainable investment and how to apply in our portfolios the concept. So in order being critical, that's a problem for us. Another important point regarding our around sustainable investment, the access to data. No? It's important to have data regarding the activities of the companies in which we are investing. So this has been considered in the European regulation with the directive of non-financial information. But this directive is going to enter into force, I think that in 2024. So now we are developing our concept of sustainable investment and taking decisions of what is sustainable or not in a company without really the direct data of the company. So, of course, it's an additional problem. So, well, I think that it's a good initiative, and of course, it's helping a lot to have regulations that are moving us in order to incorporate sustainability. But our request to the regulators is, well, try to be more comprehensive in the regulation, in the definitions, or in the timings. So,
yeah, I think what you just said just aligned perfectly with one of the highlights of the report. Just like, yeah, the need for a universal and a standardized framework, but this won't happen overnight. It will take time, and we have to be confident that in the long term we will see all the returns that we, all the efforts that we are doing now. So, yeah, thank you. Mm-hmm. And so, last but not least, sorry, Ricardo, we have a last question for you, and it's linked to the long term and one of your main claims from EDM. So you state that sustainable business are more successful in the long term, right? So could you explain us how exactly are you integrating in practice this ESG consideration with this perspective also of the long term?
Yes, we are convinced that integrating ESG criteria in the investment management decisions delivers good long-term financial results, not only for the companies, but also for the society. You know? They deliver a greater economic and social progress. We have been taking on consideration ESG criteria for the past many years, and the change in regulation that we had last year, nothing changes in the way that we analyze companies. No? We are UN pre-signatories since 2014, and we have an ESG policy that excludes some sectors, but we have to to when we analyze a company, they have to comply certain criteria, which is quite strict, regarding the three letters, no? The environment, the companies must have policies that reduces energy consumption, that they measure a carbon footprint. And this is important for us that the companies have goals, even in the short term and long term, to follow them. And at the end, the idea is that the companies that has a strong follow ESG criteria and are sustainable in the long term, they are companies that are more competitive. They have stronger balance sheets. They have normally good management teams, and they deliver at the end good better results in the future. No? And companies with high standards in ESG, we think that they deserve lower cost of capital, and that gives better returns in the long term. No? That's our approach to
that investment. Thank you very much. So, yeah, very enriching views. Thank you all for individual intervention. And now to end the roundtable, I have two quick questions because I think we are running out of time. But just like one is more, if you have any particular recommendation that you would like to highlight, or maybe any potential opportunity that we have just forgotten to highlight during this roundtable in the report. Yeah, that you think that it's really a cornerstone in the sustainability transition and sustainable finance.
One thing that I saw in the report was that at the end, climate risk and social risk are investment risks. No? And you have to take considerations and take them to reduce this risk or improve the risk reward of the portfolio. So this is important, and I think that Irina was mentioning when presenting the report. No?
Mm-hmm. And in the report, it was mentioned two things that I agree totally, and we believe in them. First of all, that the commitment of the management of the organization in order to integrate the sustainability, and the concept that this is a long pathway, and you don't have a final date. No, this is a continuous work. In order to advance in this new area of sustainable investment, there is no an specific date in which you would say, well, all has been done. It's just a new journey.
I would stick to the opportunity. I'm an optimist, and I think
we need optimism.
So I would say that the decarbonization of the economy, and not only the energy sector, brings a historic opportunity, as I said. Why do I say that? Not only energy sector. I think there's different sectors and activities, initiatives that go from agriculture, construction, shipping, tracking, aviation. All of those industries, they need to be transformed, and this will create a lot of jobs if we do it right. Actually, those who do not adapt will be left behind. That's why we need to pay a lot of attention to the transition. We need to take time to do it properly. And look, as our CEO Larry Fink said at the G20 in Venice last year, probably the next 1,000 unicorns will not be, search engines or social media. It's going to be those sustainable innovators that actually are going to help decarbonize the economy and make the energy more affordable. We've done a few initiatives, and I'd like to mention just one as an example. But last year, BlackRock and a consortium of three governments, so the governments of Germany, France, and Japan, we actually invested in climate-related technologies to basically invest in the emerging markets and make that energy a bit more affordable. And we were able to raise $700 million among institutional investors. We need to see more of that, and we are committed actually to do more of that.
That's called blended finance, and that's something that would be one of the outcomes from the COP27. I mean, it's good to have a loss and damage, but we need more money to make things happen there and to help those countries. So we are also very active on that area, and have been for a few years now. But DFIs need to change. We need more powerful balance sheets at a global level to deploy more capital and to call for private partnerships and go and invest in emerging markets, because otherwise private investors cannot do it alone and they need public ones. But, you know, I would stay with the transition planning. I think that just, and because my colleague said so before, I think that just credible transition kind of strategies, just those will unlock the finance needed, so that's important. And then I would try, and I'm sorry, I'm going to take this opportunity because it's related also something that Lara said. I think that I would like to convey this message of urgency, but together with the acknowledgement of that this is a transformational moment for everybody. I mean, for companies, for investors, for banks, for asset managers, for insurance companies. So, and nothing is done yet, and nothing will be done probably in many years. So we need to be very flexible to adapt along the way. And so the greenwash hunting mindset is not the best one to have for that kind of flexible, you know, pathway ahead. So let's focus more on what needs to be done and less in chasing what is not correct, because it cannot be perfect, okay? In this context, it cannot be perfect. Nothing is going to be perfect. But if we want to shift from brown to green, you know, we need to invest in the brown of today to make it greener tomorrow. So, but we need to put money in the brown, okay, and do it in that way. And that is not greenwashing. That is transforming the economy.
Mm. So, just to close the roundtable, maybe we can go the other way around. So just if you have to pick a headline, really a statement to comment on sustainable finance today based on what you just said, and so what would it be? Like really like a headline, maybe one sentence for sustainable investment, sustainable finance.
Okay, I go. I would say sustainable finance, and I think I started kind of saying that. Sustainable finance, it's indeed a necessary fuel for action, you know, but it's not enough. So necessary, but not enough. For it to become a real fuel, we need clear public action, we need clear climate policies, we need clear tax and pricing mechanisms that can unlock our power. Otherwise, we are very constrained and very limited. So we need clear regulation. So it's necessary, but not enough unless other things happen and are aligned and allow us to deploy all our power.
Okay,
so I would say the transition will bring a huge reallocation of capital, and we need to have companies, investors, and government working together to basically achieve this successfully.
Pues headline, I would say that sustainable finance is one of the tools that we need in order to transform the economy and the society in order to address all the problems that we have been commenting. And the first of all, of course, is all associated with the climate change and the action that is needed from now.
Well, for us, we strongly believe that integrating sustainable criteria adds long-term value to financial investments and also improves risk control.
And that coming from a CIO, it's a lot.
It means a lot, yeah.
Yeah. So many things about collaboration. So yes, sustainable finance is a fuel for action, but it's not enough. We need public action, we need more tools, we need regulation, and for sure, integrating this long-term perspective. I think you like we have really discussed about the key topics of the report, the conclusion. So I think again, thank you very much for being here. For me, it's a great pleasure to have this discussion with you. And yeah, I think we can go to the next part of the event.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you. And as every of us have talking a lot about public action. So now it's your turn. Thank you very much for being here. Ana Puente, the head of Securities Markets and Financial Instruments Legislation of the Ministry of Economic Affairs and Digital Transformation. Thank you very much. Now let's talk about public action.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Good afternoon. I would like to start by thanking WAS for their invitation and to take into account the representation of the Spanish Treasury. It's my pleasure to be here today with you. I would like to structure my intervention in three main parts. Obviously, I will be once and again highlighting the key role of the financial sector and the crucial role that sustainable finance will play and is playing now in the fight against climate change. The three parts will be to have a quick review of the main policies that are being deployed by governments at the international level, at the European level, and at the national level. We're witnessing now a higher degree of economic uncertainty. We have the consequences of the Russian's aggressions to Ukraine. We have higher interest rates. We have high level of inflation. But among all these uncertainties, we can not forget fighting against climate change as a key policy priority, as a top priority, and it still is. We cannot tackle all these uncertainties if we don't put focus on climate change, environmental objectives. And I think this is one of the main messages right now in order to talk about sustainable finance, to talk about sustainability, and so on. Sustainable finance, once again, it's about changing the way that finance works to put a focus on sustainability, on sustainable activities, identify companies that are sustainable, and to move to channel resources to them. Having said this, I would like to start with the international level. I would like to recall once again on the COP27, Raquel has explained as the main achievements, main results of COP27. I would like to focus on the 9th of November, that was the Sustainable Finance Day at the COP27. It was at the COP25, that was under the presidency of Chile, but hosted by Spain. I think that was the first year that sustainable finance has a specific day, a place in the COP. Now we can say that sustainable finance will be in every COP. It has a permanent place in this international conference. And these are good news, and we must not forget that, never. We have now a day at the COP, a specific day dedicated to sustainable finance. Well, this year, the main topics, and we have been talking about them, was blended finance, innovative financial instruments to channel all these resources that are needed. And I would like to highlight the three aspects that caught my attention. The first one was the focus on the reducing the cost of green borrowing. That was one of the work done at the COP27. Another initiative mentioned by Raquel also was debt sustainability and how to help developing countries to cope with the debt sustainability in order to overcome all these challenges. This is also crucial to look to these developing countries. And the third one was the report presented by the high-level expert group regarding the Net Zero Alliance, also focused on how to scale up and how to cope with the urgency of having all these resources in place. The report is quite exhaustive on different aspects. I would like to highlight now the reflections on multilateral developing banks that have a crucial role. They are, of course, they have embraced all this work and are changing their mindsets, and I think they have a crucial role in all this work we are carrying out. I cannot move forward to the European level without mentioning the Spanish proposal presented at the COP27 regarding the international alliance of drought resilience. Spain has much to afford there, to show and to share with other countries in all these fields. So this is a very important initiative also in COP27. Let's see what happens in COP28. And now I would like to focus at the European level. European Union, we have mentioned the legal framework as well, and I will talk about that, but the European Union is leading the way of sustainable finance globally. The level of ambition, the amount of pages also, yes, I will accept that consideration. And Spain, of course, is part of it. It's part of this leading path of the European Union. As a public sector, and in order to give confidence for investors to put their money in sustainability, we need a clear legal framework. And that's where in what we are working, even if it's not really easy. I would like to highlight how the European Union legal framework is striking balances in every single piece of legislation. In two main aspects. The first one is incentives versus binding rules. We want a legal framework that started with incentives. Let's give information. Let's have tools to identify economic activities and companies, and naturally, the money will be there, incentives. But we need also binding rules. We need scientific-based criteria for that identification process. We need comparability. We need same rules for people doing the same activity, so on. So to strike this balance is not completely easy. And the second one is time. Time, we have been talking about time, the time we have, the time we don't have. When we were negotiating the three main regulations, and specifically the taxonomy regulation, we spent 2 or 3 months around this idea. What we prefer? Do we prefer a complete, well-defined, absolutely developed legal framework in every single detail, so everyone have the full picture right now? Or once we have the full picture, we will start to work? This will take 5, 7, 10 years, we don't know. Or let's have 2, 3, 4 clear criteria decided, and let's start to work. This will be a collective learning process. Let's start now. This won't be perfect, but we need to start now. We don't have 5, 7, or 10 years to have a perfect, complete legal framework, but we need to get clear some elements that I will just recall now. So I think this is these are the main elements to have in mind when we come to a RTS proposal and say, oh my God, what is it? Yes, but this responds to that decision to start now, to have this collective learning process. I think that somehow all of us in financial sector have change our mindsets, myself, in the Spanish Treasury, regulators, supervisors. So this collective learning process is good itself, and from our perspective, is bringing real, clear, positive results. So going very quickly, because you all know the three main pillars of the European Union legal framework, we have taxonomies, scientific-based. We have all the screening criteria for adaptation and mitigation. Now we can all start that learning process. We will have a complete taxonomy for that 47 more or less economic activities, and to know exactly how can a company qualify as sustainable in order to deem this channeling of financial resources. This will be completed with the other four sustainable objectives. Do not forget the do no significant harm. This is a key, not only for the application of taxonomy and its RTS and all these detailed criteria, but generally speaking, when we are talking about sustainable finance and how to channel that in other fields of public activity. And I'm talking about the mechanisms of resilience, transformation, recuperation after COVID-19. Do no significant harm is the key tool. We have taxonomy for our business. We have the do no significant harm for other parts of public activity, and believing that it's taken really, really seriously from the design of public auction of resources to the review, the approval. It's been taken really, really seriously. Moving from taxonomy to disclosures, we have mentioned the directive on corporate sustainability reporting. We have the directive completed, we have an agreement, and now it's time to EFRAG to develop the reporting standards. We know the proposals, and now it's time to complete the work. And yes, we have to wait until 2024. Yes, no other way to fix it before, but I really think that this will be a great step forward covering data gaps. Double materiality is really important. It's the flagship, I would say, of this initiative. We are coping with other parts of the world and trying to convince that double materiality is really important. It's what we have. Maybe other jurisdictions don't see it as it is. But comparability, and let me use the word interoperability between different standards, now is key. No? Once we have this difference, it doesn't matter at all, but please do the languages compatible and not really a barrier. We don't need barriers here or the other way around, even if other parts of the world don't think that double materiality is really important. For us, is the full picture is double materiality, not only how you suffer from climate change, what are you doing? No? It's logical with transitions plan and so on. And finally, we have tools. We have, benchmarks, and we are, I hope, finalizing the work of the European Green Bond Standard. Green bonds are the seed of all we are living now. It's the from my view, the success is transparency. Once the investor knows exactly what is going to be done with their money, I think it's part of his success, and it's the key is the sense of the European Green Bond Standard label. Negotiations with the European Parliament are not easy because there are quite different views on this label, voluntary, compulsory, how to deal with taxonomy, what level of flexibility are we going to allow to market players. But anyway, it will give a clear standardization and a good. It is not bad now at all, but maybe a more regulated verification of all the process. And we think that will be a great tool in place to speed up the process. Finally, I would like to focus on what are we doing in Spain. In Spain, we have been very, very active and very involved in these negotiations and this of this legal framework, but we have done our work at home. We have a green bond. The green bond issuance is the best example of how to put all this in place. The green bond issuance in Spain has a lot of benefits. I will highlight three of them. It allows us to directly finance green projects in Spain. This is clear. Finance or refinance green projects directly, great. We have our investors. Fantastic. An indirect benefit is in the market. We have you have a clear liquid reference in the market, as you have in a regular bond. Let's put it that way. And we also need that. And it also does an example and a way for private sector responding so well to this. But there's a third benefit, maybe not so clear, not so maybe more silent. That it's how we have done in public administration this learning process, how we needed to talk with every single ministry department and to talk to them about, I've seen in the budget that you have this, tell me more, let's see how sustainable it is and if I can put it in our green bond. So this cooperation, this coordination process was incredible, positive for everyone. And it obliges us to cope with taxonomy as any other person in financial system. So it's also very formative inside. So we can see in first person what the problems and the opportunities of dealing with this legal framework and trying to be as ambitious as possible. The results were amazing, not only in the strictly financial metrics, but we had the highest qualifications of the third-party verification of the sustainability part of the bond, and this is something that we're very proud of that. Things will be better, I guess, because green budgeting is one of the main streams of the work in public administration. If you have a look to the latest draft bill for public budget in Spain, you will find a report on green budgeting and a first analysis of the alignment of our expenditure with green objectives. More in the vein of resilience mechanisms and so on, more than a strictly taxonomy, but it's an in-depth analysis, very useful, and things will be better in future for issuing green bonds and so on. I invite you to read. It's not really long, but it's very clear on the objectives and the first result we have, and what we always do here is, well, this is the first time I do it. I will do it better next time, no? And that's great, because that's the objective, that's the collective learning process. I will repeat it once again. And finally, I would like to focus on the law on climate change and energy transition. We have there two articles dedicated to sustainable finance. The first one is obligations of disclosures of different companies, and it's this sustainable finance part of the law on climate change is focused on a climate risk, how to monetize or start to monetize that climate risk in companies and to have a transparency on that. And the second part is for macroprudential objectives. Within the macroprudential authority in Spain, we are developing a report on how we see the way in which financial sector in Spain is coping with climate change. Once again, this process itself gives brings a lot of positive events. First of all, banking, insurance, and securities working together and talking a lot. This is a great value itself. FSB is also working hard on climate risk, and this is one of the main recommendations. You need to have a common approach. You need to make scenarios and methodologies compatible. You cannot do something for banks that has nothing to do with funds, and let's see what we do with insurance. You will need to adapt methodologies, you will need to adapt scenarios, but you need to talk and you need to have something in common. Otherwise, you won't see the whole picture, you won't see. It will be difficult to see interactions, and this is the most important part of that, no? More than each supervisor knows more or less how it's working its sector, no? But let's have that interrelation between different sectors. Nothing else from my side. I learned a lot with this session today, and I tried to review all we are doing at international level, European level, and we are doing in Spain in different axes: regulatory, issuance, budgeting, macroprudential, and so on. No? All efforts will be necessary to achieve the goals and the objectives we have set for ourselves and future generations. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. And now I'm going to try to summarize very briefly what we saw today, what we talked today. And I'm going to talk about talking. because today when we were at the beginning of the conference today, we were thinking, why is this in English today? Okay, because it's a common language. Because it's a common language. And we were talking today the whole journey about the common language. What do we need? A common language. Today it was English. Let's find a sustainable finance language for everybody. Let's find that. That would be my first conclusion. So let's talk about a common language. Let's talk about public and private working together, collaboration. That was the second thing that it was the whole day today. Collaboration, companies, investors, and governments working together, talking together, this common language. Third of all, climate change as the main driver, as the main aspect to be analyzed. And we need to analyze also with this common language, how do we companies translate our ESG performing into something that it's understandable, that it's sectorial understandable, but it's also generally understandable. We need the words are the metrics, the data. So we need data as a key pillar for comparable, rigorous, and of course, understandable performance for everybody. So we need the data, we need the words. And what do we also need if we are going to build that common framework, that common language? We need a dictionary. We need a common framework. And for that, we need the public action to help us all, everybody, understand this common language. And we also were talking a lot about this shifting from the how to the what. This is also very interesting. Let's come to the how, to the what. What do the companies do? What do they do? Are they building value? Are they giving value to the society? This is very important. Let's not talk so much about the how. Let's talk about the what do we do. What is that important? Now, that's the shifting also. Science-based, super important. Science-based, everything that we do, that we plan, have to be science-based. Best practices at the sector level also. And of course, we were talking about the unicorns. The next unicorns are going to help us decarbonize our economy. And to finalize, I would like to talk about this double vision also. We were talking a lot about double vision. Double vision, double materiality. Double vision, risks and opportunities. Where there's a risk, there's also an opportunity. Double vision, long-term vision versus short-term action. And that's the word of today, action. Let's keep on doing. Let's not try to be perfect. We're going to be perfect in the future, not now. But now we need to practice, because if we want to build this common language, we need to practice. We don't wake up one day and say, okay, I can English now, I can German now, no, I can French, no. We need to practice. So let's practice. Let's build together this common language, practicing collective learning. The greatest danger to our future is apathy. That's not my words, that's Jane Goodall words. So Jane Goodall said it. Let's action, let's act. Let's be together, let's collaborate. Let's do something together, let's build that common language for everybody so that everybody can understand, everybody can act now, today, for tomorrow, for the future. And we started today with culture because someone told us about Liza Minnelli, Money rules the world, money makes the world go round. So we started with culture, and in WAS, in Women Action Sustainability, we like to end all our things, our journeys, with culture too. So let's build together this common language. Thank you very much for being here, and let's end with a little bit of culture. Thank you.
¿Vives en España? Pues es oficial. Somos uno de los países de la Unión Europea que peor lo va a pasar con el cambio climático. Nuestros veranos ya duran 5 semanas más que en los años 80, porque en los últimos 50 años la temperatura de nuestras ciudades ha subido el doble que la media mundial. El Mediterráneo sube 1 centímetro cada 3 años, dibujando en nuestras costas un mapa de posibilidades espantoso. Hasta nuestras enfermedades son ya distintas. Nos hemos pasado los últimos 100 años emitiendo gases de efecto invernadero. El que más, dióxido de carbono. O sea, gases que calientan la Tierra. Ya nadie habla de evitar el cambio climático. Ahora los científicos hablan de cómo podemos adaptarnos a la nueva situación. Porque está aquí para quedarse.
¿Cuántas veces hay que morir para no vivir en paz? Mil me quieren ver sufrir, otro mil me asegura. Es verdad, toco el cielo. Es verdad, toco el cielo. Que la aparenta que me tofue. Mi collar en el cuello que lo usé. Mi collar arrancó por el suelo.
take you somewhere.